presentation, he will be happy to answer your questions. Professor Hossam.
Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Vascular access for hemodialysis patient in the white line. Maintenance of hemodialysis access is a cornerstone study of long-term venous replacement therapy. Access to the circulation became a reality in 1960 when Scribner introduced the Scribner shunt, which was a celastic tube passing between the artery and the vein. Was an external tube, okay? One limb is introduced inside the artery and the other inside the vein. During the dialysis, there is a connector here connecting between the two tubes. And during the dialysis, this connector is open and the two lines are connected to the dialysis machine. Actually, this was a difficult procedure. And it has a lot of complications, and it is very difficult to be maintained. But this was the innovator to introduce the vascular access by arterial venous fistula. In 1966, Scribner, Brescia, and Semino introduced the radiocephalic arteriovenous fistula. Radiocephalic arteriovenous fistula, and this was the first trial to have an arteriovenous connection, native arteriovenous connection. Actually, since then, we are trying to introduce new methods to conduct hemodialysis for chronic renal failure patients. I think all of you have tried using hemodialysis catheters, whether the tunnel or non-tunnel catheters, to deal with the chronic renal failure patients. Okay? You are confronted usually with the hemodialysis catheters or not? Yes. And how many of you are in your centers using the arteriovenous fistulas for the patient? Yes. We will talk at first about hemodialysis catheters. We have different varieties of hemodialysis catheters, the single human and the double human hemodialysis catheter. This is the temporary catheters, which may be which may be single lumen, as I said, or double lumen, or sometimes you have three lumen catheter. One for the arterial, the other for the venous lymph of the hemodialysis machine, and the third for aspirating samples and introducing drugs during the dialysis. This may be straight like this, or curved like this. The shape, the tip of the catheters have a lot of variation, as we all know. Maybe configuration of the tip like this, as we all know, the long limb is the venous limb, where to aspirate the blood, and the short limb is the arterial limb to reintroduce the blood inside the circulation. And there must be a distance between two limbs to prevent the circulation of the blood inside the dialysis machine, which would reduce inefficient dialysis. We have also split cast with the tip of the catheters. We have two tubes detached from each other at the tip of the catheters to prevent recirculation. Also, different shapes of the tip are produced to prevent recirculation. The other one is the tunnel catheters. You know the difference between the non-tunnel and the tunnel catheters? Okay? Yes. The difference is actually the tunnel catheter is a longer one and it has a Teflon bleach. This Teflon bleach is produced, is inserted inside subcutaneous tunnel to attach the catheters to the subcutaneous tissue, and at the same time it acts as a safety valve against infection, as a mode to prevent an infection through the catheter. Addition of this tunnel and the Teflon bleach make the catheters what we call it a long-term catheter, which can be maintained inside the body of the patient for about 6 months or more. While the non-tunnel catheters are used only for short periods, short-term hemodialysis, usually not more than 1 month. Actually, the National Kidney Foundation guidelines recommend inpatient to have dialysis for more than 1 week. And when we plan to have hemodialysis for more than 1 week, to use the tunnel catheter and not to use the non-tunnel catheter. Both of them, the non-tunnel and the tunnel catheters, are introduced usually through the internal jugular vein to pass to the superior vena cava, and the tip must present inside the right atrium. The tip should be inside the right atrium. This is the non-tunnel, where we have a puncture of the vein in the neck, and then short course of the catheter to the right atrium. Here is the tunnel, the catheter, the skin hole is present away from the site of vein puncture, and all of this is a subcutaneous tunnel. Just above the skin exit, there is the Teflon cup. Teflon cup is placed here to attach the catheter and to act as a valve against a protective mechanism against an infection. Other way, other sides to introduce this when we have the internal jugular closed is the left internal jugular. We didn't recommend at all to use or to introduce hemodialysis catheters through the subclavian vein. Yes. We didn't recommend at all to insert the hemodialysis catheter through the top clavian vein. Okay? Why? Didn't know why, any of you didn't know why? Why we didn't recommend to use the hemodialysis catheter? Yes. Yes. Actually, stenosis. The incidence of.
So, what is the problem of stenosis? What we are afraid of stenosis? Okay. Nice.
Nice, very nice. insert the catheters, it must usually, we recommend to put the catheters under fluoroscopic control, under X-ray control, to ensure the tip of the catheter is present in the right atrium. It is not go downward or it is too short. We recommend to insert the catheter under fluoroscopic control. Okay? Many of you are inserting hemodialysis catheter. Okay?
Do you use a screen, fluoroscope for inserting the catheter?
No.
And Professor Dunia gave them a workshop about the use of ultrasound.
Yes. Ultrasound is very valuable during the insertion to identify the internal jugular vein, but it will not follow the tip of the catheter inside the right atrium. If we didn't do, actually, in my practice, I usually didn't use the fluoroscope, but I have to do an X-ray after fixing the catheter to ensure the proper position of the catheter. If we didn't use the X-ray during the insertion, we should do a plain X-ray after insertion, posterior view of the chest, to ensure the position of the tip in the proper place, roughly.
Excuse me, Dr. Hossam.
Yes.
It is not only to be sure that the catheter within the site, targeted site, but it's also of medical legal. Suppose after your insertion of the catheter, the patient died, and you don't have X-ray showing that the catheter in place, I can say that you injured a vessel and there was catastrophic pneumothorax that killed the patient.
Yes.
So for medical legal purposes, plain X-ray should be done after catheter insertion.
Yes. And to ensure that there is no, as Professor Hussain said, there is no hemothorax, no pneumothorax, we have no problem. The proper position of the catheter and the absence of complications. But hemodialysis catheters have a lot of problems. The main two problems is catheter malfunction and catheter infection. By catheter malfunction, we mean improper dialysis due to either thrombosis or obstruction of the tip of the catheter. Okay? For catheter malfunction, this may be due to kinking or improper tip placement or thrombosis or the presence of fibrin sheath or fibrin flap. Actually, most of these, the three, could be diagnosed by a plain X-ray. What's the problem in this catheter? Why this catheter is not functioning well? Yes, it's not in the proper place. The tip is present in the enomic. It doesn't go into the superior vena cava and the, as we all say, in the side right atrium. For us, during introducing or fixing the catheter, what's roughly the rough measures on the chest wall to ensure that our tip, when we measure it on the skin, when we measure it on the skin of the patient, we will measure to what? What's the landmark on the our chest? Yes. Yes, use a sternal angle. You are right. We must have the two openings of the catheter, the two holes, just below the sternal angle to ensure that it's inside the superior vena cava and reaching the right ventricle. Okay? So we measure the length of the catheter and to introduce a lens to reach just below the sternal angle. What is the problem with this? Yes, where is the tip of the catheter? The tip of the head also it is in the enomic. Another problem, it is introduced through what? Subcutaneous. It is not accepted as vein to access the circulation for hemodialysis, and also it is more properly placed in the innominate vein. What is the problem with this? Yes, you are right, excellent, it's a king. Actually, it will not function well. What's the problem with this? It is introduced in through the left internal jugular. This proper. But what's the problem? What passes? This we may confront, actually. We introduced the wire and we didn't know where the wire goes. In this patient, the wire goes through the hemiasticus vein. And we will aspirate, no blood come out. When we inject, the blood passes, because we inject inside a vein, but we cannot withdraw because it is a very small caliber vein. The wire goes from the internal jugular directly to the hemiasticus vein. Left hemiasticus vein. So we cannot detect this except after we will have a blade X-ray. What is the problem with this? This catheter was functioning very well, aspirates blood very well, but the blood is pulsating inside the colon. Okay, this is a great problem. When you puncture the neck, the needle puncture the carotid instead of the internal jugular. So it passes from the carotid to the arch of the aorta and then going downward inside the aorta. And this actually, because we are not using ultrasound or doublet during an insertion, you may puncture the carotid artery. How we can avoid this clinically? We should palpate the neck before or during introduction of the needle. So we should palpate the artery and make sure that we protect it by our left hand while inserting the needle. The vein is lateral to the carotid artery. The internal jugular vein is just lateral to the carotid artery. So we first palpate, ensure the position of the artery, and going just lateral to it during the insertion of the catheter. How we can treat clinically when we introduce the catheter and we find that it is not functioning well? Okay, if we do an X-ray, and we found it is present in the proper place, but the catheter is not functioning well, how we can treat? We can only change the position of the patient. Instead of having the patient conducting hemodialysis while he is lying flat, just make him to have a 45-degree elevation of his head, changing the position, making him to lie on the right side, to lie on the left side, just changing the position. Why? X-ray shows that the catheter is present in the proper place, but it is not functioning. It may adhere to the wall. Just the tip of the catheter adhere to the wall, to the wall of the atlet or to the wall of the spheroid in this position. Just changing the position of the patient will make the tip go away from the wall and function in this.
أنا بصبح بس
منور والله
الله يخليك
منور بس. If we have just slight thrombus, slight thrombus inside the catheter during at the end of the session, the working nurse does not inject proper heparinized saline inside the catheter, so as a small clot formed at the tip of the catheter. How we can treat this? Simply, if we have the catheter not functioning well, we can have an heparinized saline and do repeated aspiration and injection to dislodge this small thrombus out of the catheter. Okay. Sometimes we solve this problem by passing the guide wire through the lumen to dislodge this small thrombus. Okay. We can also use reversal of lines using the blue line for aspiration and returning blood through the red line for one session. Actually, this will reduce recirculation, but it is better than having no dialysis at all. The last resort to use is the use of thrombolytic serum, streptokinase or urokinase or tissue plasminogen activator, injection inside the catheter, leave it for 1 hour, then aspirate it and re-inject thrombolytic agent until the thrombus dissolved it completely. This is provided that we do a plain X-ray and we ensure the catheter is present in the proper place. If all of this fail, pass the wire, remove the catheter and introduce another one along with the wire. Why catheter infection is more serious? We have exit site infection, tunnel infection, and the most serious is catheter-related bacteria. And I think all of you, if you are using catheter, faced with catheter infection, which is the main cause for catheter removal. Actually, in our country, the main cause of catheter removal is catheter infection. We leave special the tunnel catheter inside the patient until catheter-related bacteremia develop and we cannot treat. Okay, catheter site exit site infection and the tunnel infection could be safely treated by antibiotics, but catheter-related bacteremia is preventable. How we can prevent catheter-related bacteremia? It's a preventable. We should follow complete asepsis in our hemodialysis units. We should have clean environment around the patient. We should have clean instruments while in dealing with the patient. We instruct the nurses to use striped gloves in each time she is dealing with the catheters, introducing fluids, connecting the lines, disconnecting the lines, frequent dressing. We should follow all the aseptic techniques. This is number one. Number two, at the time of catheter fixation, the first time while you are fixing the catheter, you should use antibiotic inside the lumen of the catheter. Two, because the biofilm inside the catheter formed in the first 24 hours after insertion, after fixation of the catheter, the bioline, the biofilm formed inside the catheter. If this biofilm dislodge bacteria, the patient will have catheter-related bacteremia and it is not corrected. We cannot treat. So, the first time you're introducing the catheter, add the lock solution, introduce antibiotic at the lock solution in the first time you are fixing the catheter. Okay? Some recommendations are using a solution known as Torolock solution. Do you know Torolock solution? And you're using the Torolock? Okay. Torolock solution is a bottle, okay, refilled. It is present in the market, containing torulidine. Torulidine is not an antibiotic, it is an antiseptic material. And inside it, there is also citrate to prevent thrombosis. It's formed of torulidine, antiseptic, and citrate. And it is used to lock the catheter after each hemodialysis session. You didn't use heparin, you didn't use antibiotic, just you have the bottle of torulidine, aspirate the volume written on the catheter, each line has a line, including the capacity of the line, 2.5 centimeters, 3.2 millimeters, aspirate the written number on the lock of the catheter, aspirate it from the bottle, and they inject inside the line after each dialysis session. This prevents catheter-related bacteremia and the catheter infection, but it is costly. This is, what is this? What is the problem with this? Exit site infection. Yes? Yes. The second method, and it is the recommended method, is the use of arteriovenous fistula. All the catheters are tender. or the Caster's artery. Salon tunnel must not be used more than 1 month. The tunnel we can use up to 6 months or even 9 months unless the patient doesn't have Caster-related bacteremia. But the permanent method, the permanent lifeline for this patient is arteriovenous fistula. Okay? This is the varieties of the native arteriovenous fistula. This is the most common variety, or the first variety, which is radiocephalic. Okay, when we have connection between the cephalic vein and the radial artery, here is the brachiocephalic, here is the transposed basilic vein and anastomosed to the brachial artery. Here is the loop, side loop, using the saphenous vein. Sometimes after we exhaust all options in the upper limbs, we go to the lower limb and we have saphenofemoral fistula connecting the great saphenous vein to the femoral artery as a loop. Okay? Here is the using the vein as we use the forearm vein, we use the vein as a loop anastomosed to the brachial artery, and here is we use the long saphenous vein as a graft between the brachial artery and the axillary vein. All of these are native arteriovenous fistula. We are using the native veins of the patient. Okay? But in many cases, after exhaustion of this or due to absence of suitable vein, we shift to the use of arteriovenous grafts. How many of you are dealing with patients with arteriovenous graft producing synthetic materials? Only you and you. Actually, it is a great option, okay, and a valuable option for the patient who doesn't have suitable vein or absorption of their veins during previous access. This is some of the configurations used. We use synthetic graft between the radial artery and any suitable vein at the elbow. This is forearm graft. This is a looped graft. We put the synthetic graft subcutaneously, anastomosed here as a loop, anastomosed to the brachial artery and any suitable vein, either the vena comita or the cephalic or the basilic at the elbow. Here is the brachial axillary graft between the brachial artery and the axillary vein. Okay? And here is axillary artery and the axillary vein loop graft. All these are configuration we use to put a synthetic graft subcutaneous to act as a way for that. We use it, we puncture through the graft. We put the two needles inside the synthetic graft. Another option, we use chest wall graft. If we didn't have, if all of this are used, and this is actually a reality. In our country, we have patients maintained organ dialysis for 20 years. They have 20 years hemodialysis. He exhausts all of these options in the upper limb and in the lower limb. We shift to use synthetic graft over the chest wall. We put the synthetic graft over the chest wall between the axillary artery and the axillary vein. Like this, our vein pass from one side of the axillary artery in front of the sternum to the other side of the axillary vessels on the other side, or passing along the upper part of the arm from also the axillary artery to the axillary vein. All these are great options for the patient who have exhausted all of their lines. Okay. How we can select the site of permanent access? Many of you have vascular surgeons in dealing with such patients. You have vascular surgeons in your countries, or the urologic surgeon who do arteriovenous fistula. Vascular? Okay. When we select the site, we use